Okay, so this is the Monasca Bootcamp. I guess this is one of the first sessions of the OpenStack conference. Who went to the keynote this morning, by the way? Yeah, how was it?
Good.
Good. Awesome. So this bootcamp is really a hands-on lab, so I'm not going to be doing a whole lot of overview on Monasca today. We'll go through, in terms of what it is and the architecture. I'll do a couple introductory slides there, and then we'll do more of the coding. But this is all driven by an IPython or Jupyter notebook. If people are familiar with that, you can go to that GitHub address there. And there's a repo, Monasca Bootcamp, and then there's an IPython file. We're not going to be doing like a hands-on session where I'm going to expect you to do a lot of coding and everything. I'm going to be the hands today. I'm going to drive you through this whole thing. There's a lot of material. I really encourage you to, you know, take it offline, get DevStack and the Monasca plugin installed, and then run through this offline. And then if you run into any issues, please ask questions in the in our IRC room. Or, you know, there's a couple of contexts there. So I'm Roland Hockmuth. I work for Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. There's my email address. And then my colleague and coworker, Michael Hoppel, is also on the presentation. He's not here today. But he actually did all the submission work for the paper and worked on the notebook with me. Okay, so this will be really an experiment doing this. I've never done this big of a deal with IPython before, but we'll give it a try. There's also a number of folks attending the summit here. I don't know if I say your name, stand up. But we've got Declan Dieterle. He works with me also at Hewlett-Packard. Brad Klein and Ryan Bach from TWC. I guess they're over there. Sid Logan from Broadcom has been doing a lot of stuff on network monitoring of Broadcom switches in a project called Broadview. Witek Bedek from Fujitsu will be doing a paper session later today on logging using Monasca. Unfortunately, he's stuck in Chicago, so he's going to be a day late, but he should be here hopefully arriving at 1 o'clock, or else I'll be doing the whole presentation on my own, which that'll be an experience. Okay, so we got Koji Nakazono from Fujitsu, Shinwa Kawabata from NEC, Fabio Giannetti from Cisco, and if I missed your name, I'm sorry, I tried to remember all this off the top of my head, but hopefully I covered most of the folks. So they're all here at the summit. If you got questions, you want to follow up with folks, please feel free to do that and reach out to these folks. They're often in the IRC room as well and can help you there. Okay. So as I mentioned, this is an IPython Jupyter notebook that you can run on your own. It's at that GitHub site that I listed earlier. So after you install IPython, then you'll want to install DevStack using the Monasca DevStack plugin. And if you follow that link, you'll see some directions on doing that. It takes around half an hour or so to actually get it all installed and up and running. That's why I didn't want to do this today. So I thought I'd just drive you through the notebook. And then there's a bunch of Python libraries that I use in this presentation that are kind of independent of really Monasca, but I use it for displaying graphs and querying things and other stuff. So we'll cover that real quickly. So this is the agenda. I'll do a quick architecture and overview of Monasca, just so you're familiar with it at that level. By the way, who is familiar with Monasca? Okay. Okay, so I'll be covering that set architecture overview very briefly. There are presentations at previous summits. I encourage you to take a look at the videos if you want more information on that. Also, if you really want a more in-depth session while you're out here in Austin, you know, send me an email and maybe we can get some time together and go through it. Okay, so this is the bulk of the session is really on the API and CLI. I don't know if we'll cover too much of the agent hands-on. We'll get a little bit into, if you're a developer, you know, how to get started, where to go, current status and what's next, and then the grand finale will be the Horizon Grafana 2 demo. And I really do have to be careful on time here, because there's a lot of material. The notebook is a lot bigger than an hour and a half, I think. But I've never done the presentation, so we'll find out. Okay, so what is Monasca? Monasca is monitoring as a service at scale. My friend Declan Dieterle over there thought of this incredible name, which he loves to remind me about. So basically, it's for OpenStack monitoring as a service, and it's based on a first-class RESTful API. By first-class, I mean all the operations that you would do for the monitoring service are done via the API. Normal monitoring systems, there's usually, you know, proprietary protocols or other protocols. Ours is based on our HTTP RESTful API. It's highly performant, scalable, and fault tolerant. We spend an awful lot of time trying to do that. And it sorts authentication via the Keystone OpenStack service, and then multi-tenancy. Everything in the service is scoped to a tenant or project ID. We store metrics that are generated usually from a monitoring agent. We have our own optional Python monitoring agent. And then you can query those measurements and statistics back out of the system and then display them or look at them somehow. There are multiple ways to slice and dice the metrics, and alarms based on filters and sorting options. I don't think that red is nice when I was creating that slide. So using our metric naming mechanisms and metric name and dimensions, which we'll get to, there's multiple ways to slice and dice the data, like by region or host name, and that's all very configurable. You can create alarms and receive notifications on those alarms. So you can do like status and health monitoring, for example, like if you want to monitor HTTP status, we have a plugin to do that. And in that case, the metric would be a binary data, a 0 or 1, and then you can create an alarm on that. And I'll tell you if your API or your service is down. We also do, you know, everything's a metric in terms of the monitoring. So if you like want to monitor CPU, you can create an alarm off of a threshold of like CPU utilization greater than 80%, and then alarm on that and send you a notification. Notifications we'll get into later, but they can be email, PagerDuty, or webhooks. It's a very extensible platform. It's designed around part a technology called Kafka. Kafka is a highly performant, scalable, distributed, durable message queuing technology that originally came out of LinkedIn. Over the past year, 2 years, it's really been adopted by the big data community. And so we use that within Monasca. That's an excellent technology. What that allows you to do is tap into our message queue if you've got additional components that you want to add, or via the REST API, of course, you can query and the API and add on your own products externally to the system. And it's designed to consolidate monitoring for both DevOps and monitoring as a service use case. So when a lot of people think about monitoring, they're thinking about, like, you know, monitoring their physical infrastructure. So using like Nagios or Ganglia or Zabbix or any one of the number of tools out there for doing that. Monasca is monitoring as a service, and since it's a multi-tenant system, we use it for both of our, we use it for both operational monitoring and monitoring as a service use cases. Monitoring as a service being things like Amazon AWS CloudWatch, or Datadog, they're here at the conference, by the way, I believe presenting. But there are a lot of, you know, monitoring as a service as companies out there. I don't know, New Relic could be another one, Librato. But basically the way they operate is you have an HTTP endpoint that you can publish metrics to, query, get data out, create alarms in some cases, and do other analysis. That's what Monasca is also about. Turns out if you can do monitoring as a service, you can do both your operational monitoring, and that's a really good thing because if you have to deploy a system to do your internal monitoring of your physical infrastructure and a separate system to do monitoring as a service, that's two systems, not one. And I've supported, I did DevOps for the HP public cloud when that was still around. And we had three systems there. We had monitoring service, we had Nagios, and we had our metrics processing system. That was three systems. That was a lot of operational overhead, and now we can do that with basically one. And that's in part why this system is here today. Okay, so this is the overall architecture for Monasca. We're not going to spend a lot of time on this today, but I did want to show it to you. Okay, so we have our REST API. It's the horizontal bar in the middle there. Up in the upper right is our agent. That's optional. You can use other agents as well or send data directly from your application via the API. The data is published or posted to our API, and then it's published to the blue box in the middle, Kafka, which is our central component. And I like to think of this as a microservices message bus architecture. These three components down there, the persister, the threshold engine, and the notification engine, they consume messages off of that queue, and they also publish messages back. So the persister is basically consuming all of the metrics off of the message queue and publishing them or sending them to the metrics and alarm database. Our metrics and alarm database today is either InfluxDB, which is an open source database, or Vertica, which is a proprietary database from HP. We've been looking at supporting other databases as well. So that's the job of the persister. It also stores our alarm history. So the threshold engine creates alarms, but the alarm history is also stored into the database. So we have all the history of all our alarms, and you can go look at that later on and see what happened and do root cause analysis later on after an incident has occurred. Okay, so the threshold engine, that is written using a technology called Apache Spark. Apache Spark is a computational engine. You describe a graph of, they call them bolts and spouts, but basically they're inputs, outputs, and computational nodes. And so you describe this topology, and you can do stuff with it, really cool stuff there. It was developed by Twitter for their real-time streaming analytics that they do on all the tweets that are being generated. So we use that for evaluating our alarms. So when we receive metrics, we look at each metric, say, okay, is this above a threshold or below a threshold? We do moving window average calculations on all that data or other statistics, and then if the state has transitioned, we output an alarm state transition event, and that's what's actually stored in our database to the right, the metrics and alarms database. Okay, so the threshold engine then publishes this alarm state transition event. That goes to the notification engine, sort of on the left there, the lower left. Notification engine receives those messages, consumes them, looks at them, decides what to do with it. If that alarm state transition happens to match something, a notification, like an email or pager duty notification, then it'll send that out. That engine also handles, like if the message isn't successfully sent, so if, like you do an email and your SMTP server is down, then it will send it, put it on a retry queue using Kafka. And then it'll try a minute or two later. The lower box on the left there is our config database. That can be MySQL or Postgres. That's basically storing all the configuration information for the system. So like what are all the alarm definitions and alarms that are in the system as well as the notification methods. So that's not the streaming content. That's a much smaller content. And the difference between the two is that content is being updated, it's being created. It goes through a CRUD lifecycle. So you create it, read it, update it, and delete it. And it's not this big data stream with a lot of velocity to it. It's, you know, much more transactional in nature. Whereas our metrics and alarms database, that's the high-speed streaming metrics content that's flowing into this thing that you want to be able to query and get out information really fast. Okay, let's see what else. So we have integration with Horizon up in the upper left there. So from Horizon, you can visualize, well, you can interact and do all the CRUD operations on the API. Not shown in the diagram here is, we also support Grafana too. That was developed at that Time Warner Cable recently added. We supported Grafana 1 for about 2 years now, but Grafana 2 was recently added a few months ago. And just like every other project within OpenStack, we have our own Python Monasca client, which you can use to query the API and do things with. And that library also has a built-in Python library that you can, you know, import into your Python code and use it to interact with the API as well. And I'll be showing lots of examples of that if I ever get through my architecture slide. Okay, so that is kind of at a high level the architecture. And I'll cover a few more things. So there's a picture of, one picture anyway, of Horizon. I'll do a demo of that later. You can see on the left there, the monitoring panel. And there's these four sub-panels there, overview, alarm definitions, alarms, and notifications, those being the primary resources in the API. And then you can interact with that and create alarm definitions, read alarms, create notification methods, et cetera. It's a screenshot of Grafana 2, not a terribly exciting screenshot, but just wanted to throw that at you, show you what you can do with Grafana 2. This is showing the CPU user percent here over, I don't know, half an hour, it's worth of data. And this isn't completely integrated into Grafana 2 yet, and I'm not sure it will be, but the last update that I saw from the project lead on the Grafana 2 project a few days ago is that they will be adding this into Grafana 3.0. There are some pull requests up there, and if you're interested in using that code, you'll have to do a little bit of work on your own, and that is documented, and Ryan Bach is in the audience, and he's the guy to talk to about that if you are having or experiencing problems. One of the other things that we're doing in Monasca is logging as a service. So we are in the process of adding a logging API. Currently we have an API that you can post log messages to, and there is a repo out there. There's a spec, and there's a presentation later today at 5:15, and that'll go into a lot of detail on that. So if you're interested in that topic, that'd be worth attending. That was also covered at the Tokyo Summit. So we have some updates on that. Okay, there's also integrations with a lot of other projects. You know, Monasca is still a relatively new project, but we have integrations that have been going on. So Solometer is out there, and Solometer does collection and storage of, well, Solometer does, one of the things it does is it collects metrics for OpenStack resources. So we've integrated with that, so you can send the metrics that are collected into Monasca and store them there. And then we've also built Monasca as a storage driver into Solometer. So basically the Solometer API can sit on top of Monasca and query all of those, all that Solometer data that's been stored in there. And that, the usage of that will be, it's in very good state, and that will be going into production here this week. HPE will have some announcements on that. So that work is basically being used by HPE in their Helion distribution. And there are others also that are looking at that. There was a presentation at Tokyo if you want to find out more about that, and a nice repo. Heat auto scaling, we also are supporting that today. There was a presentation at Tokyo, and there was a presentation, well, it's not purely Monasca related, but there, I think that will be covered to some extent, that's going on around heat and to some extent Monasca auto scaling at the Austin Summit too. But the Tokyo presentation was really good, and you can check out that video if you want. I mentioned this earlier, but Broadview is a new project that is up in the OpenStack organization. There's actually three repos there. But what that project allows you to do is physical network switch monitoring, and we're looking at doing other things with it, like neutron monitoring and OVSDPK monitoring, or like virtual switch monitoring, et cetera. So that'll be, we're gonna have some more discussions on that on Wednesday morning at around 11 o'clock in one of the Monasca sessions. And Sid Logan, who's right there, can tell you more about his project if you are interested in it. And there's a session on Congress, enforcing application SLAs with Congress and Monasca, and that's using Congress to do policy management, but using Monasca to trigger alarms and tell you when certain thresholds have been exceeded, and then Congress takes over from there and applies their policy engine framework to take actions. Vitrage is a new project. There's a couple sessions, and we're starting to look at some integrations there. We'll be talking a little bit more with them while they're here. And Neutron, as I mentioned, we'll be talking to that team on Thursday. Networking is a big area of discussion. Okay, how am I doing on time? Terrible. All right, so this page here imports some libraries that I use throughout this presentation. You got to initialize the Keystone and Monasca client, so obviously supply your Keystone URL, project name, username, and password, and then initialize the Keystone and Monasca client. Not terribly interesting, but I'll skip over it. We use Plotly for graphing in this Pipe notebook, and we use Spur for running remote commands. So Plotly is a really cool graphing library, and there's other ones that are used in the IPython community, like Matplotlib, but I like Plotly. Okay. Using the API, finally, we're there. Okay, so I hope I don't bore any of you to death here by going through all this. We're gonna go through this API. It's a hands-on session. And we'll go through all the resources pretty much and have little demos of them. So those are the resources. We've got a versions resource, or metrics, a measurements, a statistics, a metrics names resource, notification methods, alarm definitions, alarms, alarms count resource, and alarm state history. But first, before we do that, let's go review a couple common concepts that are important. Roles. Our user control access to the API. So there's three roles in the system. There's a user, agent, and delegate role. The user role allows client access to all the CRUD operations on the API. The agent role allows you to post metrics only to the API. So obviously the agent could be deployed in lots of systems throughout your environment, and just to reduce the security threat security attack vector, that was the word. The agent can only post to the API, can't query or create things in the API. And then there's a delegate role. The delegate role is used by our agent to publish metrics from one account to another. And we use that in our physical infrastructure monitoring when we're actually monitoring VMs or OpenStack resources. If you have a VM that you're monitoring, like our agent is monitoring, running on our physical hardware, we're getting metrics for that VM, which can be many tenants. Like if you had 40 VMs running on a physical compute node, those VMs could be running under multiple tenants or owned by multiple tenants. So we can publish the metrics to those tenants as well, so the tenant can access metrics about their VMs. Okay. And then pagination. Pagination is really important. When you have lots of data to deal with, you need to page through it. And we have a limit in our API today of returning 10,000. You can deploy, if you want to set that limit yourself and deploy it and use a larger paging limit, you can do that. But that's meant primarily to prevent the API or the database from getting extremely large queries and failing. So the limit, like I said, is 10,000, and when you get a request back, you should see, is it 10,000, or if you supply the limit as a query parameter, you want to see if it's equal to that value, and if it is, then you should start to page through that. And there's offset and limit parameters. This is a technique that's used in other OpenStack APIs. But using the offset and limit parameters, you can advance through the elements in your result set. So here is an example. Ooh, that kind of. So if we first, let's just list some measurements using a limit of 6. So right here, we've done a command line. I'll be doing a little bit more of this later. But we've done a command line. We've queried for CPU user percent. And we've got six measurements that were returned. OK, so now let's go page through this. So if we do this again, same query with a limit of 2, we get those two values. And what we're going to use as the offset in the next query is that timestamp, the second for the last element in that query. So if you look at that timestamp there, that will become the offset on the next query. Ooh, that wasn't what I expected. Well, you can't see it, but it's there. So sorry about that. The screen resolution changes caused a couple problems here. So anyway, if you're interested in pagination, there's a wonderful example for you to go through. OK, so metrics. So this is one of our resources. So you can get and post to metrics. And so a metric consists of a name, which is a string. And there's a couple conventions that we normally follow when naming things. Usually it starts out with a group, like CPU, or MySQL, or RabbitMQ. And it's all lowercase. And then we have a dot. A dot delimits groups. And then we have some additional information after that dot, like user underscore percent, or if the group was Kafka, consumer underscore lag. And then it might also have a suffix on it with some units, like if you were looking at network in bytes or out bytes, we'd have something like underscore bytes. Dimensions is really important. Dimensions is a dictionary of key value pairs, and dimensions in combination with the metric name help you uniquely identify a metric. So if you've got some metric called CPU.user%, but that's reported for 1,000 hosts, you would typically have a dimension called host name, and the value of that key would be hostname 1, hostname 2, hostname 3, and so on. Okay, so dimensions, we have conventions, of course, that we follow. But you're welcome to create your own dimensions with the API and come up with whatever you want to come up with your name conventions. But we use things like region, zone, mount point, device. There's a bunch of these dimensions out there. So you have a timestamp that's a part of a metric. You have a value. Value is a float. And then there's this other thing called value meta that looks like a dimension, but it isn't. It is a dictionary of key value pairs. But value meta isn't there to uniquely identify your metric. It's there to tell you additional or information about your metric. So, like, for example, our agent allows you to run Nagios plugins. And a Nagios plugin runs, it reports a status, OK, warning, critical, or unknown, and message. That message has useful information that you might want to supply with your metrics. So you can now go look at your metrics and go look at the value meta. So if you were monitoring a service, and that service went down, and you were doing that via an HTTP status metric, you could provide the status code returned. It could be like a 400 or a 500 error. And a message might be in that metric as well. And there's also you can supply for various requests a tenant ID that allow you to do delegation I talked about. So there's a slide here on dimensions, so I kind of described that. Dimensions are really important because this is what you're going to use to slice and dice your data. You're going to say, well, give me the metrics for that host, or give me the metrics for that region. So you can use it to delimit what you're really interested in looking at. And those are some other examples. I left off resource ID being the ID of the OpenStack resource that you're dealing with. So that's supplied in the case of VMs. Okay, so this is an example of a metrics request body. The name of this metric is, it should have an underscore there, HTTP underscore status. And we've got some dimensions. It has a URL in this case, a region, a zone, and a service. So this would be maybe testing the Nova API. I doubt my port number is correct in this example. A timestamp in milliseconds, a value of 1, and then the value meta status code of 500, which is internal server error. The value of 0 would be that the API is up and OK. A value of 1 would be that the API is down. OK, so that's a command line of metrics. And I doubt people can read all that. So I won't do all that. All right, so this is just an example of creating a metric. So this is all done in IPython. So we have the exclamation point, which allows me to run command line commands in an IPython notebook. So I'm bang Monasca metric dash create dash dash dimensions, and then region equals US Central, state equals Texas, city equals Austin, and I lost some of my scrolling there. And it has a value of something like 1. Okay, and then I run a query on that metric. Oh, the name of the metric was openstack.hands-on-status. So I successfully created that metric, and now you can look at what's in the database and store it as a value. Let me check my time. Okay, so now we can go list metrics. So that's done on this endpoint, get v2.0 metrics. And you can specify as a parameter, like a metric name and its dimensions. The start, end time, offset, and limit parameters are also available. And just a note, if you're doing this and you ever deploy and you've got millions of VMs in your environment, you need to start delimiting the number of metrics that are returned. And usually you want to limit that maybe to some time range because you're only interested in looking at metrics for the past 1 hour, 24-hour period. So that's really important because after a few months, if you're running, you'll have tens of millions of metrics in your system if you have a large deployment, of course. It's less important if your deploy is relatively small. That is the command for getting help on metrics. And that's an example of some metrics that are in the system. So there's the command, metric-list. I'm limiting it to 10 metrics in this case. And on the left column here, we've got the names of our metrics. And on the right column here, we have the dimensions associated with each metric. And this is a pretty small, this is done using just the dev stack deploy. So there's really not too many metrics in the system right now, but any large deploy, it'd be very common to have tens of thousands for your physical infrastructure and for all your VMs that are continually changing and being added and deleted. You could have easily millions. So this is just another example of using the metric list command to filter down to just the metric name cpu.user_% with the dimensions of host name equals dev stack. And then we can also create a function to get metrics in Python. And this line here is the line that's actually invoking the, Monasca client and getting those metrics and returning them. And we'll use that. Okay, so metrics names. So if every time you interacted with Grafana, if you had to query and get all the metrics in the system, that would take a lot of time to get that result set. But often when you're going through and looking for a metric, you're saying, I'm interested in looking at, you know, something, right? And the number of unique metric names in your system might be hundreds, okay? Now, obviously, there's lots of dimensions associated with them. So there might be a metric name called CPU user percent and another one called system percent. You get the idea, there might be hundreds of those, but the number of those same metrics for the entire deploy might be huge. So the names resource allows you to do queries. It's very useful in the Horizon or Grafana dashboard, where you're just going to limit and say, I'm interested in just the names. And that is an example of that query. Well, that's the help for it. And that is an example. So in the previous example, we had the column on the left were the names and the column on the right were the dimensions. This is just the distinct elements that are in the column on the left, the metric name. Okay, so measurements resource. So you write all these metrics into the system, you're going to want to look at them later on. So the measurements resource allows you to query that. So you can say get v2.0 metrics measurements. You can supply the name and dimensions as query parameters. The start and end time, offset, and limit can also be supplied to delimit the range of data that you're interested in. And if you're getting more than 10,000 elements back, you're going to need to page through it. So you'll need to do offset and limit parameters. And currently, you can only get measurements you can only get one array of measurements back. So if you're doing a query and you were looking at, in your query, you didn't filter down to a single unique metric, but let's just say you were running a query and you say, give me CPU user percent with no dimension of host name supplied, then you can use this merge metric flags to merge all that data into a single array. So that's really important. If you really are interested in each unique metric independently, then you'll end up having to run a separate query for each one. However, there is a review in progress, and that'll allow you to get multiple metrics in a single request, and that'll be a significant performance improvement. Okay, so there's an example of listing the measurements. So in this case, we've specified a dimensions of hostname equals dev stack, and we've limited it to 5 measurements. The name is not showing up here, but it's cpu.user_percent, and we get 5 values back. Okay. This is just creating a function called get_measurements, and we're using the Monasca client on this line to get the measurements back and return them with some additional coding around that. Okay, and this, I don't know if you guys are familiar with pandas, but pandas is the Python analytics data library. So I use pandas in this notebook to create data frames and then display them using Plotly. So that function there sets that up so we can convert measurements into a data frame. Okay, so we're going to, this line, we're just using those two functions that we just created. We get some metrics. We're getting 2 metrics in our case, CPU user percent and CPU system percent. And then we plot them using Plotly. First, we convert to a data frame. And then the command dataframe.iplot uses Plotly. It actually uses cufflinks, which uses Plotly. But so right there, we're displaying CPU and system percent. The red is user percent. And that's kind of cool. One of the things that I'm interested in doing is doing online sort of in real time sort of data science on your monitoring or on your cloud. Okay, so the statistics command is similar to the measurements. You can get data back that you've put into the system. So you got names and dimensions again, but additionally you have the statistics parameter, which is currently just limited to average, min, max, summer, count. And then you can specify a period. A period would be the time interval at which you're interested in applying that statistic, so like 5 minutes would be a good value. So it's done in seconds, so 300 seconds would be 5 minutes. You can do it in an hour, you can do it on 24 hours. And then you can specify a start and end time, also an offset and limit. But you can basically say, I'm interested in the average of CPU utilization over a 24-hour period in like 5 minute periods. And similar to the measurements query, it only returns one list. You can use merge metrics flag here too. And that same review that I mentioned earlier, that is up, will allow you to do multiple metrics in a single query. So that is the command line for running that. That's a function to get statistics similar to the previous one. That converts to a data frame. And now we'll go ahead and run this command. And it's not terribly exciting, but that is a plotly graph of CPU. It's multiple metrics in this case. There's user percent, idle percent, stolen percent, and others that are in this. Okay. And using Plotly, it's very easy to create box plots. So in this case, the middle line for a box plot is the mean. Then we've got, I think this is the upper quartile is the upper line. The lower quartile is the lower line here. And then the top bar, lower bar, is the min and max. I think that's what they're doing in this case. So this could be really useful if, like, you wanted to understand the CPU load across your entire infrastructure and which systems were, you know, basically anomalous in a sense. So you could quickly say, okay, go ahead and return me all the CPU user percent for my entire infrastructure, right? And then I could display a box plot on that and see which systems are got high means, low means. Basically do visual analytics on your infrastructure. In this case, though, I'm not doing that. I don't have a big infrastructure that I have access to here for this demo, but I am displaying these CPU user idle, stolen, other percentages. And you can see that the idle percent, which is in blue, is much higher than all the other percentages. And since there's nothing on my system running, that is normal. Okay, so notification methods. Basically, within Monasca, you have you can connect notification methods to alarms. You do that by creating a notification method with a name, type, and address. And then once you create that notification method, you can query it or modify it or delete it. We support email, PagerDuty, and webhooks. So that's the command line for creating a notification method. Obviously, it specifies those three things I just mentioned. So this is an example of creating an email notification. So we've got the name of the notification method here. And then the type is email, and the address is john.doe@domain. You can also do pager duty. Unfortunately, my VM that I'm running in can't get onto the internet. So I was going to have it call me and do a really cool demo, but that's not possible. But I did have the screenshot here. So if you're familiar with pager duty, you can grab the integration key out of that. And on this line, create a notification. And so it's running off the scroll here, but the name of this notification method is Monasca Bootcamp PagerDuty notification, and then that value would be the type. Oh, it showed up. Let's see if the next one shows up. PagerDuty, and then the address would be the integration key. So you can list your notification methods after you've created them. Okay, so that brings us to alarm definitions. And alarm definitions is, so there are operations for creating alarm definitions. One thing that's different in Monasca is you don't create alarms directly. What you create are alarm definitions, and you can view alarm definitions as templates for which metrics, as they arrive into the system, are matched against the metric name and dimensions that you've added to your notification method. And if there's a match and an alarm hasn't been created already, it'll create one. And then as new metrics arrive, they'll go to that alarm. And basically what this allows you to do is I can create one alarm definition in my environment, and I can generalize over lots of systems or resources that I'm monitoring very easily. So if I wanted to monitor my physical infrastructure and get a warning message when an alarm or when a metric value was greater than 80%, I could create a single alarm definition for doing that. And then in that case, I'd have many, many metrics showing up, all of the name, CPU, user, percent, but a dimension of host name would be different. And there's an additional value here called match by, which I need to describe as well. But what you can do is you can say match by host name. You can also think of it as a group by operation. In fact, that might have been a better name for it. But as these metrics arrive, you can say, I got a CPU user percent metric, and host name is foo in one case, and host name is bar in the other case. If I say match by host name, I'll end up with multiple alarms being created. There's a simple grammar for creating alarm expressions. That is an example of a compound alarm there. So we're taking the average of CPU user percent greater than 85, or the average of the disk read ops with a dimension of device equals VDA. And in that second alarm, the period is 120 seconds. And if that value is greater than 1,000, then we'll alarm on that. There are three states of an alarm in Monasca. There's the OK state, there's the alarm state, and then there's the undetermined state. The OK in alarm, that's pretty much self-explanatory. OK means I'm within my threshold. Alarm means I'm outside of my threshold, above it, below it, whatever the case is. And undetermined means I had an alarm that was created, but there's no metrics being sent to it anymore. So we call that the undetermined state. And this can happen for a lot of reasons. You might have had a physical host that you took down. So if you had a bunch of metrics, like CPU user percent being sent from a system, and then that system crashed, you wouldn't be getting metrics anymore. So we use that undetermined state to help tell you that it's not that there's an alarm, but that you're not receiving metrics anymore for it. Other reasons, like a VM, VMs are, there's a high churn rate in, you know, systems that use OpenStack with creating and destroying VMs, especially if you have auto-scaling enabled. And so every time a VM gets created, metrics get created, and then when the VM goes away, the alarm, if you have an alarm set, would go to the undetermined state. In addition, there are four user-assigned severities with your alarm definition: low, medium, high, and critical. Okay, so when you create an alarm definition, let's just say you want to do a warning alarm on CPU utilization greater than 80, you would specify the severity as low. And then let's just say you wanted a high or a critical alarm if the CPU was greater than 95. Then you would assign that, and you'd create two alarms in that case, alarm definitions. Okay, so that's an example of creating a simple alarm. So there's the expression. For some reason, I use 60 is the period, 80 is the value that we're comparing against. And you can't quite see, for some reason, it didn't display correctly, but as you go to the right, you can look at that. Compound alarm expression doesn't show up, so we won't go through that. So I kind of described this match by thing. It's kind of hard to grasp when you first encounter it, you know, what you need to do. But you know, basically I described as metrics come into the system, you can group them. You can say group by, and you could specify some dimension. You can group them by region or host name or you know, any dimension that would be a part of a metric. Skipping over here some stuff because I described some of that. And we're coming up on an hour. Okay, so now you've created your alarm definition, and then the system, hopefully you got alarms that are being automatically created. That's what would normally happen. So what you want to do is you want to look at those alarms and query them, or and so you can do that. You can say get me a list of all the alarms, and if there's thousands, you might have to page through that. You can also get, put, patch, delete a specific alarm by ID, and there are several query parameters, like the alarm definition ID, the metric name, metric dimensions, state. You can also sort these. So, you know, you're going to have tens of thousands of alarms in your system if you have a large deploy. And if you are interested in displaying them, you can do like server-side filtering and sorting on them. And we support a number of options for doing that. And that's really important because if you want your user interface to be responsive, you can't just query all of the alarms back into the browser and operate on them there. You need to do that server-side and get it in its in the format that you want it. So there's a lot of options on alarms and alarm definitions, but I'll just kind of give you the overview on that. In this example here, we're listing all the alarms and we're sorting by severity. And it's really hard to read here, but somewhere here, here's my state column right there. And I guess everything is in the undetermined state. So I got to work on that little example. But anyway, I'll move on. OK, alarm counts. So alarm counts allow you to get the counts, the number of alarms, in various states or severities, or also grouped by various names or dimensions. And why would that be useful? My next slide will show. So this is an example of the Helion Ops console. I'm not trying to do an advertisement here, but I'm just, this is the only diagram I had. But what this is showing is that compute, right, so this would be the Nova service here, has one alarm in a critical state, zero in the warning, zero in an unknown, and 35 total. And that's where you really need to use the alarms counts resource to get that information. Because if you can't do it, if you didn't have server-side API for doing that, you have to query and get all those alarms and then do this calculation. So that's where that resource is important. That's the command line. And that's just running on the command line. Filtering on service equals monitoring and grouping by state and dimension name. And I guess I didn't have any alarms in the system when I ran this a few minutes ago, so sorry about that. Okay, so alarm history. I hope we're getting to the end here of resources, but the alarm history allows you to go back and query and look at the states of all these alarms. So alarms are, you know, some people think of alarms as like when it actually occurs, that was the alarm. And the way we think about it is an alarm is a persistent object in the system. It's a resource. And that alarm undergoes these state transitions It can go from okay to alarmed and back down again. Also the undetermined state. So what the alarm history, though, allows you to do is query the states of all your alarms. And you know, this is really useful if you have like an alarm that's flapping, for example, might be going up or down. You can look at that history very quickly. If you want to do like root cause analysis on something after the fact, you can do that. All that history is there. It's kept, you know, indefinitely unless you prune your database. And what else? You can, you know, as an alarm occurs, if you're an operations guy, you can go back and look at it and say, what's up with that system? Right, maybe you have a system that's got a, you know, a hard drive that's going bad or something. You can look at that. So lots of ways to use the alarm history. I wanted to show graphing an alarm history along with metrics. I didn't get to doing that in my demo today, but that's something that'd be kind of cool, is to basically show your metric and then show various problems occurring and then plot as data points in your system the points where your alarms transitioned and the metrics simultaneously. Okay, so, oops, I kind of skipped over here. I probably don't have an alarm history to show you because I didn't have any alarms. Okay, we've gone through the whole API now, which is pretty good. I skipped over a bunch of stuff. So I didn't want to bore you with every single command in there. If you want to go run all this stuff, you have access to my IPython notebook and look at the examples. I want to change the topic now to talk about the agent a little bit. So with Monasca, in addition to, you know, on the architecture slide, there was all those components that were listed. There's also a Python monitoring agent. We use this within the Helion deploy, and T-Tie Mortar Cable is using it, and others are using this. Let's see, I think my next slide talks about what it monitors. Yeah, all right, so let me get through this slide. So Monasca is a push model on metrics, so we push metrics into the API. Usually the agent is installed on the system that you're monitoring. We also do what we call active checks, borrowing kind of the nomenclature from Nagios, but active checks would be where we run the agent on a system and it's actually monitoring another system. Like it might be monitoring whether that system is up, or maybe monitoring the API to see if the API is up. We call those active checks. So you can do that with our agent as well. It has a pluggable architecture, so you can plug in various plugins to monitor things, like services, like MySQL or RabbitMQ. We have some plugins now for monitoring OpenStack services like Swift. And there's also, with the agent, a way to use the setup script. We wrote a lot of the setup stuff when we were building Helion. And as I found out, it doesn't quite work with DevStack. So sorry about that. But you might need to do a little bit of work if you're trying to get this working on your own systems. But anyway, it's there. It probably is not too difficult to get that to work with DevStack, and we'll work on that. So what are some of the things that the agent can monitor? So I mentioned CPU, memory, network, file system, a lot of your usual system metrics. We can do service metrics like RabbitMQ, MySQL, Kafka, and many others. Application metrics, it has a built-in statsd daemon. And then we extended that statsd capability with support for dimensions. And so dimensions are, you know, one of the central concepts in Monasca that we needed to extend the statsd capabilities with. We can monitor VMs. And so we get a lot of VM metrics like CPU and memory and networking type metrics. But we also do like host alive checks on VMs or ping checks. Host alive check actually uses libvirt. Ping check is a little bit better because when you do a ping against a system, it actually involves the kernel and the host status. It's called a host status check, sorry, in the case of a VM. But in the case of a host status check, using libvirt, you can't always tell that the VM is running because the kernel could have panicked. With a ping check, you can do that. A variety of active checks can be run, like HTTP status checks and system up-down checks. We support Nagios and CheckMK as plugins. So if you have a Nagios deploy already done, and you've got Nagios plugins written, and this is something that Time Warner Cable did, you can basically deploy Monasca and start using those Nagios plugins right away. Now, Nagios plugins report OK warning critical or undetermined states. So we turn those into metrics, 0, 1, 2, or 3, and then you'll have to create alarm definitions for them to actually trigger when things go to the warning or critical states. But you know, you can basically, if you're interested in moving from Nagios to Monasca, that basically makes that transition much, much easier. And that's extensible. You can add other plugins to that. All right, how am I doing on time? Okay, so let me get through a few more slides. I'm not going to go through the agent example here. I spent a lot of time on it, though, but I'm not going to do it. Okay, so if you're a developer sitting in the audience right now, I'd love to have you working on Monasca. We do have a number of companies and organizations involved in the project. So this next section will just give you a few pointers on how to get started with the project, and feel free to follow up with me on things. But Monasca kind of started out with more of a Java code base, and then we've been doing a lot of porting in Python. But depending on the component that you're interested in working with, it might just be purely Python, or there might be both Python and Java versions of the code available. There's a Monasca DevStack plugin, and that's what I'm running on my system right now. And that's also used by the OpenStack CI system. And it's basically similar to any other OpenStack project. We've got a lot of unit tests, and we have around 150 Tempest tests. Okay, so I mentioned that Monasca is a microservices architecture, microservice message bus architecture, and so we have a lot of repos. Most OpenStack projects have like a couple repos. They have like a Nova repository and then a Python Nova client repository. We are a little different on Monasca because we have all those repos there. So we have one for our API, one for our persister, one for our threshold engine, our notification, the agent, statsd library, the Horizon component, Monasca UI. We also have our Python Monasca client. TWC has added a Puppet Monasca. And then we also have our new Monasca Log API, which is only Python. The direction for the project is to head more and more towards Python. So most of our new development for new components is Python only. But we've got these other components that have both Java and Python. So that's something to be aware of. If you don't know Java, then you want to be involved in the project, then there are certain components that you could work with. Of course, if you want to work on the full project, then you might need to learn Java. We try to keep those code bases in sync, right? We are very careful on the project. Going forward, right now, today, you can run all Tempest tests pass 100% with either the Java or the Python components, and we basically try to maintain full compatibility between them. In fact, if you look at the architecture slide, every one of those components there, if a Java or a Python component exists, you can use one or the other. And that's regularly tested that way as well. So you could have a Java API for a Python persister or the other direction, or you could go all Python or all Java. The notification engine is purely Python. The Python Monasca client is purely Python, so you can stay and do purely Python. And the log API is all Python. Okay, I mentioned this DevStack plugin. That's where you would go to install the DevStack plugin. The best way to get started on that is to clone the Monasca API. CD into the dev stack directory, and if you use Vagrant, type Vagrant up, and that will install the whole thing. Tempest tests are in the Monasca Tempest test directory in that same Monasca API repository. And that's also run in our OpenStack CI process. And that's what I just said. Okay, so there's a couple of ways to get in touch with the Monasca team. And I just want to make sure I got enough time to show the Horizon and Grafana demo, and I think I will. Okay, so those are the ways to get in touch with us in IRC. So we have regular weekly meetings on Wednesday morning at 1500 UTC. And then we have our own OpenStack Monasca room, which if you're trying to get a hold of me, it's hit or miss with me, but there's other people in there and they'll get me if I'm not in there. Okay, so what's new in the project? In the last couple months, if you've been watching the project at all, we have added a lot of enhancements for filtering and sorting resources that return arrays. And that is really important for, you know, things like, or tools like Ops Console, or you're trying to do summary and overviews, overview type pages, or you're trying to page through lists without having to bring in the entire database into your browser. Multiple metrics is in progress that allow you to query and say, give me CPU user percent, and you'll get back a list for every single like host in your environment. Sporadic metrics is something that's in progress that allows you to support event-based metrics. So most metrics you think of as them as being periodic. They're sent every 30 seconds or a minute, whatever your collection time interval is, and that's configurable. If you have something that's event-based, like something's up or down, or in our case, where this came up was when we're trying to integrate with the logging system and count or emit metrics for each log message. So obviously, errors in your log files, hopefully there's not many of them there, but when they do occur, they're event-based and they're usually due to some problems. So with what the direction that we're going with the logging system is to event a metric directly into Kafka when like an error occurs or something else that you're interested in a log file. So you can use Logstash for parsing on your log messages and then emitting messages back into Monasca. And from there, you can threshold on values. Like I say, hey, if I get an error message, I want an alarm to go off and then send a notification. Periodic notifications is something in progress, and that's really focused on better enablement of auto-scaling with heat. And so a periodic notification is a notification that will be sent periodically, like every minute. Today, our notifications are one shot. When the alarm fires, we send a notification. We don't send any more. So periodic notifications will be primarily used with webhooks to notify heat that the alarm is still in an alarm state, and then they can make decisions. And that's how the heat architecture works around that. Okay. So some things that are happening with the project right now. One thing that's happening, there's a blueprint that was just put up, but we're adding what we call the Monasca Transform and Aggregation Engine. If you can recall back at the architecture slide, we had those three microservices, one for the persister, one for the threshold engine, and one for the notification engine. The transform and aggregation engine will be at that same level in that architecture diagram. And what that'll do is it can read incoming metrics, and then it can aggregate them together. So let's just say we had metrics from Swift across all the Swift proxy servers in my environment, and I want it to create an aggregate metric that is the number of bytes sent or received from Swift by project or tenant ID. So I want to do a grouping operation on a tenant or project ID. The aggregation engine will receive all those metrics, and then using its built-in analytics capabilities, it'll go ahead and sum or total that metric by whatever you're grouping by. In this example, that'd be a project ID. So look for that if you're interested in that, and it's a great time to get involved, I guess, with that. Monasca Analytics is something experimental, but a couple years ago I talked about doing anomaly detection with Monasca. I didn't make much progress on the anomaly engine, but we have some folks now that are interested in doing this, as well as what's called alarm clustering or correlation. So, you know, in a system where you have many, many alarms going off, you can suffer alarm fatigue, right? That's the typical problem for an operator. So let's just say a system goes down. All those alarms about that system would potentially trigger and go to the undetermined state. What you'd like to do is cluster things together temporally, as well as based on other identifiers in the metric, like dimensions in it, for example, a hostname. Okay, so that's the other focus on that project, and that's kind of experimental, but we have some folks from HP and Fujitsu that are interested in this area, and we're hoping to put more time and energy into that over the next few months. And then Monasca Events, this has been on the list for a long time with the project. Hopefully we're going to get to this in the next few months, but basically adding the ability to add complex event processing. The canonical example that I've used in the past is OpenStack notifications being sent, like VM lifecycle events getting sent into the system, and then if a VM end event occurs, triggering on that and deleting like something, or taking like an alarm associated with it, or doing some other action. Some other areas I'll be talking about later this week, retention periods in Monasca, compression at the API level, more performance. Performance is continually looked at within our project, and so we always talk about that, how to make things faster. It usually involves optimizing your database queries, potentially adding, just like we have the metrics resource, adding a names resource. And network monitoring is a big area that's starting to come up, and how would you use Monasca to do that? Obviously, we have the Broadview project, but we're going to be talking to the Neutron team later this week, and hopefully we'll come up with some good ideas, and at the next summit, maybe we'll be presenting them. Just an advertisement here. If you're really interested in Monasca more, and this would be developer-focused sessions, we have from 9 to around 2:30 on Wednesday morning, if you're interested in attending that. That was my recruiting thing. Okay, so now to Horizon. Okay, so here, looking at that screenshot earlier, we have the monitoring panel, and I can go to the overview page. There's not a whole lot of excitement here happening right now. I'll show you that in a second. But what this monitoring page is showing you is, well, we've got, you can go go to Grafana from here. This first row here is for the services in my system. We're currently showing that the monitoring service is experiencing a problem. That's why it's yellow. And then as I was going through that whole IPython notebook, I ended up creating some metrics that had a host name of foo and a host name of bar. But the real host in the system is DevStack. And so the first row is grouped by services, and the second row is grouped by the servers. Okay, so what we're going to end up doing here, and there's actually metrics being sent to this system right now, but the problem is I don't have an alarm definition created for it yet. And the metrics that are being sent into the system are called HTTP status. So we're going to create an alarm definition called service status. And we're going to say if the max of the metric name, so these are all the metrics that are in the system right now that I'm paging or scrolling through. And so we're going to select the one with HTTP status. And we're going to say if that value is greater than 0, I want to, that'll be my threshold to alarm on it. Now this next section here, it says the matching metrics. So earlier I was talking about match by or grouping metrics by some dimension. And what the system right now is showing me all of the unique metrics that happen to match this alarm. So there's service equals glance, service sender, service neutron, swift, salometer, and nova. So those are metrics that are being sent to the system right now for each one of those services. And they're all metrics that we know about in the system. And so what I want to do is I want to create a separate alarm for each one of those services. I've got two choices here. I can create one alarm for everything, right? Or I can create an alarm for each service independently. So this line right here, which is already pre-populated with URL, host name, and component, I'm just going to strip off that, and it's going to say match by service. And I can supply a description. Status of service. Not being very creative today. And severity, we're going to give this a critical. If my service isn't down, that's critical. And email notifications, it's not going to work if I select the PagerDuty one or the email because my VM doesn't have, I couldn't enter the passcode into my VM. So anyway, it's not really on the internet. So neither one's going to work, but we'll select Monasca Bootcamp PagerDuty one anyway. That was actually created in the IPython notebook. So it successfully created that alarm definition at that point. So how many alarms do you think are created? Let's go over here now. Well, let's go back to the overview page. Oh, wait for it. Wait for it. Uh-oh. Did I forget to set? Oh, there they are. Okay, so it takes a little second there, but now we've got this row populated. Okay, so alarms are sent every 30 seconds, and then there's the built-in evaluation period that our threshold engine uses, so it's not immediate. And then you can see that many of them are in this gray state right now. That means they're in the undetermined state. And it'll take about another minute for them to be in the OK state. So basically, that's kind of the model around how alarm definitions are used, as you know, basically as services are deployed. And you know, usually for your physical infrastructure, you don't have a huge churn rate, or you know, you're not constantly bringing up services or down, and hopefully they're staying up all the time. But when you're dealing with OpenStack resources, it's a little bit different. So, you know, this does apply to, you know, your physical infrastructure, but it's even more applicable to, you know, OpenStack resources. Okay, so in this case, Nova turned red here, and the reason why it turned red is, I'm synthetically sending these metrics into the system right now. I gave it a value of 1, and that's why it's red. And all the other services are going to turn green here, and we can come back to that. Okay, so that's alarm definitions. You can look at each alarm. Let me make sure I get to the Grafana. Okay. So the alarm definition was called service status. You can go click on that, look at its description. You can go edit the alarm definition, etc. You can go look at all the alarms were created by listing them. So here's all the alarms that are in the system. Many are still in this undetermined state. Actually, they were created earlier, so but we have the new one that I just created. So you can page through that, look at all the alarms. Then the other panel in here is the notification methods. So we could, you know, if we wanted to create a new notification method for John Doe, can't spell, okay, email, that'd be John .do.domain.com. Okay. Oh boy. There it is. Okay. So I created that notification method. That doesn't generate notifications until I actually associate it with an alarm definition. So if I go back to my alarm definitions, I can go look at the service status one. I can say, I really want John Doe to be notified when the service status alarm goes off, and I can select John Doe from there and save that away. Okay. So that's kind of the what we've got built into Horizon. And let me go back to the overview page right now. And okay, so everything is green except for Nova, which is what I expected in my case. I have a little Python program that's looping through and generating synthetic metrics here. If we click on that, we can now drill down on Nova and say, what's wrong with Nova? And we can show the history of that. And there's really not a very big history, because I ended up clearing my history before I did this IPython notebook. But had this value been changing over time here, we would see a lot more alarms. But let's just see what's shown here. So we have a timestamp. That's when the alarm transitioned. We have the old state, the new state. We have the dimensions associated with that alarm and the reasons for it. Okay. So I'm not going to correct that alarm right now. That'll take a little too much time. I did want to show you Grafana and how that's integrated in with this. All right, so from this overview page, I can hit the Grafana button. And I'm going to log in as user Minimon. And all right. So in Grafana, there's something called data sources. So the first thing, if you're using our DevStack plugin, is you'll have to enable Monasca as a data source. I already did that, and there's a screenshot of that in the IPython notebook. But here's what you're doing. You're saying, OK, I'm going to name for this data source. It's called Monasca. The type of it, it's Monasca. I'm going to make it the default. The URL. That's interesting. Yeah, it's John Doe. I thought it was PagerDuty, actually. Every time I run through this IPython notebook, PagerDuty calls me. They're like, it can't be. I thought we were off the network. I said that like 10 times already. But that was from New Jersey, so somebody's trying to get me. All right, so that's using Keystone authentication, and we can test that, and everything's working. Cool. So you'll have to do that manual step. And you can go back to the dashboard here and start populating it. So I'm going to say, go ahead and create a new dashboard. And I'm going to add a graph panel to this. And I'm going to just go with the measurements. So this first selector here is for which function do I want to supply to the metric. It can be none, or it can be average, min, max, summer count. So I'm going to say none. And then which metric I'm interested in. So if I click in there, I can now scroll through metrics. So I'm going to select CPU user percent. And well, I'm not automatically updating yet. So now I recycle that. So that's the CPU user percent. You can see this is over the last 6 hours. You can see this time was here was probably when I was in my hotel room updating the slides. And then I walked on over. So the system was down and then something like that anyway. So that's why that looks funky like that. I can go in here and say, oh, I'm interested in the data for the last hour. And I can also, whoops. Say I want to automatically refresh, so every 30 seconds will be good. Okay, so that's the CPU utilization. You can see it's hovering at around 5%. What I normally do here is sometimes what I do is I go in and I'll go ahead and say, oops. Come on, kill that. All right, while true, pass, okay. All right, so that'll put a spin loop on that. We can go back and look at CPU utilization and see if I was telling you the truth. I don't want this to be a magic show. Okay, so let's see. So now we can come in here again and we can add another metric. Panel, oops. Oh, that's not working quite. I don't think it likes my, what I did with, I don't think it liked what I did with going back into full screen or something. Or zooming, what happened here? All right, let's go try it once more. All right, well, we'll create a whole new panel. We'll say, we'll take the average this time of, I don't know, HTTP status. And it should be good. Well, I'll say, pick another one. Oh, I know which one. Kafka. K-A-F, consumer lag. Okay. Cool. It's not what I expected. All right, well, I think my demo kind of got messed up here. Oh, no, okay, we're fine. This is just not what I expected to see. All right, so in the top panel now, we've got CPU utilization. In this bottom panel, we've got Kafka consumer lag. And we could spend a bit more time cleaning that up and showing you exactly what you want. But that's kind of the Grafana integration that's available right now with Monasca. Oh, one other thing. So just to show you, we can show you the last 5 minutes of CPU utilization after I created that spin loop, our CPU jumped up, right, about a couple minutes ago. And that's it for the presentation. Hunt me down this week if you want to know more about the project. Wednesday morning, another advertisement. We'll be doing some developer sessions on that. If there's any quick questions that people have, we got like a minute or two left. So,
actually, a question for me. The what's backing Grafana and Horizon is basically a plugin in the case of Grafana and custom code, I suppose.
Right.
And they're all using that Monasca API to construct what we saw here.
Yes.
In terms of like the menu items and that kind of thing.
Right. Yeah, so the Grafana plugin, or really it's a Grafana, it's a, the Monasca data source to Grafana is interacting with the Monasca API. It's not going to the database. Oh, thank you everyone for attending.